Ready? I'd like to welcome all to a tree commission lecture tonight. And first of all, I want to thank the Williamson County Master Gardener Association who made this lecture possible with grant monies. And I also like to thank the City of Franklin Tree Commission who has helped me look and get speakers for these lectures. Tonight, we have Dr. Greg Weaver here. And Dr. Weaver is a radiologist with Radiology Alliance practicing in Nashville, and he is a resident of Williamson County. Dr. Weaver is the past president of the Tennessee chapter of the American Chestnut Foundation and has been growing chestnut trees on his farm in Williamson County for the past 20 years as part of the work to restore the American chestnut to the forests of the eastern United States. He is the author of several articles and book chapters about the American chestnut. His interest in the American chestnut tree goes back to his childhood woods walks with his father, who remembered the chestnut when it was still an important forest tree. His father introduced him to the tree's tragic history and kindled his lifelong interest in bringing the tree back. Dr. Weaver's lecture will discuss the history of the American chestnut blight, its devastating effect on the American chestnut, and the work underway to bring this important tree back to our eastern forests. So help me welcome Dr. Weaver.
Thank you very much, Todd, and welcome to everybody here. I'm glad that all of you have come out tonight to hear about the American chestnut tree. I can't imagine anything more fun to do tonight than for me to talk to tree people about my favorite tree. So I look forward to telling you a little bit about the American chestnut tree and what's going on with it and what happened to it, why it's not here, and about the work to restore it and bring it back. This is my son on the street that went by his college dorm, and you can see he's living on Chestnut Street. And I know many of you probably took your children off to college, and that's a pretty significant family change. Your children are beginning to establish their own identities, they're moving off, and it can be kind of emotionally stressful. But I was comforted to know that my son was living on Chestnut Street. That just made me feel good. But I walked up and down Chestnut Street, and there were no chestnut trees there. Could not find any. I saw a lot of oaks, but not a single chestnut tree. Franklin has Chestnut Lane, which is over there behind the factory, and I haven't looked, but I would be willing to bet that there's no chestnut tree on Chestnut Lane either. How many of you have seen living American chestnut trees in the wild? Okay, a couple. So the majority have not. And that's an interesting thing, isn't it, that we've got chestnut streets. Chestnut at one point was one of the main trees in the United States, and only a couple of people here who are tree people have actually seen one in the wild. How many of you have eaten American chestnuts? Okay, one. Very rare thing, but 100 years ago, it would have seemed like a nonsensical question. It would be like me standing up here tonight and saying, how many of you saw a computer today? Or how many of you saw a car today? I mean, chestnut was so ubiquitous, it was a part of everyday life, and that's all gone. And so it's been quite a remarkable change over the past 100 years. Chestnut belongs to the genus Castanea, and there are 8 different chestnut species around the world today. The American chestnut, which is the topic of our talk tonight, of course native to the eastern United States. There are 2 other chestnut species native to North America. The Allegheny chinquapin, which is a bushy form of chestnut, its range roughly parallels that of the American chestnut, only it's a much more narrow range, mostly up in the mountains. And there's the Ozark chinquapin, which grows in the Ozark area of Missouri and Arkansas. It's more of a tree-like growth than a bush growth, but it doesn't get as large as the American chestnut. We have the European chestnut. That chestnut tree was widely disseminated by the Romans back a couple of thousand years ago, and it's now found all the way into Ireland and on up into the United Kingdom, as well as in mainland Europe. Over in Asia, we have the Chinese chestnut, and then 2 minor species, the Castanea sanguinei and the Castanea henryi, that are not as common as the Chinese chestnut, not as commonly transplanted to the United States as well. And then there's the Japanese chestnut over here. Historically, in the remote past, there are chestnut fossils that are found in Greenland and also in the western United States. There are no native chestnut species in either of those places now. There are a lot of chestnut trees growing in the western United States, but they're transplanted Americans or Chinese or European or hybrids. During the Ice Age, the northern part of North America was covered by a huge continental ice sheet. Tennessee had conifers. If you want to see what that looks like, you go to the tops of the mountains in the Smokies, and you still see the spruce fir forest. It retreated upslope where the climate was is now cooler, similar to what was present in the lowlands back in the Ice Age in Tennessee. The hardwoods were pushed down to these constricted ranges down here along the Gulf of Mexico. And sea levels were about 300 feet lower during the Ice Age than they are now. So a lot of these refugia are now underwater. But it was a very narrow range. That's where all of our hardwoods came from, these little areas here, relatively small areas down in along the Gulf of Mexico. After the Ice Age and the melting of the ice sheets and the warming of the climate, then trees started to recolonize the eastern United States. The arrows here are in proportion to the rate at which they move north, a chestnut being fairly slow as those things go, moving north at a rate of about 100 meters per year. Maples with their winged seeds, they had a little bit of propulsion about them, they could go faster. White pine and hemlock, smaller seeds, and they already started from farther north being conifers. And so then by the end of the 1800s, this is what the Chestnut Range looked like. Tennessee was almost entirely within the Chestnut Range, and I'll show you a more detailed map of Tennessee in just a minute. But you see the range really went all the way from southern Mississippi all the way up into Canada and Ontario and all the way up into Maine. Now that's quite remarkable. You think about the same species living in southern Mississippi and up here in Maine. That's a pretty adaptable plant. The American chestnut did not travel west of the Mississippi River. The same eco niche is occupied there by the Ozark chinkapin, so it's entirely east of the Mississippi River. There's some interesting things here. You see these little kind of outlier islands of chestnut. About the time the colonists arrived to colonize the eastern United States, they brought with them Phytophthora, and plant people, many of you probably know about Phytophthora. It's classified as one of the world's most invasive and deadly pathogens of plants. It kills not only chestnuts, but it kills about 1,000 other different kinds of plants, including oaks and just about any other kind of plant you can think of. And the theory is before the colonists arrived, the American chestnut range actually went farther out in the Piedmont, maybe out even into the coastal lowlands. But Phytophthora grows best in moist, low-lying areas. And so there was a sudden constriction of the range of the chestnut. So that explains that. But this is what the range looked like around the end of the 1800s or so. And you might guess that in the southern end of the range, the biodiversity, genetic diversity of chestnut is greater than north because fewer individuals would have migrated north, and that's exactly right, and that's been investigated by Paul Sisko and Finney Dane. It's yet one more reason we're privileged to live in Tennessee. We have more genetic diversity here in chestnut. This is from an article by Joe Shibig, who is a biologist at Volunteer State Community College who has researched chestnut ecology. And it shows the relative abundance of chestnut across the states of Kentucky and Tennessee. In Tennessee, chestnut was most abundant up in the Appalachian Mountains and the Smoky Mountains. About 25% of the forest cover there was American chestnuts. Think about that. One out of every four trees was an American chestnut. Now that's amazing that you would have a tree that is that successful that it can outcompete everything else and do so well in that type of environment. Chestnut became a little less frequent as you headed west, but still was pretty common in the Cumberland Plateau and the Highland Rim, constituting around 10 to 15% of the forest there. Williamson County is right here. And if you head west in Williamson County, you know, you start to get into the hills. Well, that's the Highland Rim. The Highland Rim actually encircles Nashville. And it's a very different plant community in the Highland Rim than in the Nashville Basin because you have acidic soils and better drainage. The Nashville Basin has limestone-based soil, so you have more of an alkaline pH. A chestnut prefers strongly acidic soils. A pH of 5.7 is fine for chestnut. And you don't really get that in limestone-based soils. So the Nashville Basin and likewise the bluegrass area of Kentucky, neither one of those places is a particularly good place for chestnut to grow. In West Tennessee, where the land becomes lower, wetter, and more swampy, chestnut doesn't like that as well either. It doesn't like wet feet, so chestnut became less common as you went farther west. And this is what an old-growth chestnut forest looked like. This photograph was taken around 1905. in western North Carolina in what is now the Joyce Kilmer Wilderness. And many of you have probably been there. It's one of the most spectacular places to go if you like big trees that you can think of. Even without the chestnuts, it's a spectacular place. But just look at that. You see the people here for scale, and look at the size of those American chestnuts. That forest is just overwhelmingly magnificent, just looking at an old black and white picture. Can you imagine what it looked like if you actually were there walking around in those trees? It must have been just absolutely overwhelming. This tree grew in the Smoky Mountains close to Tremont. This is the Shelton family. You see one of the boys here has climbed inside the hollow tree. Older chestnut trees commonly became hollow, which was a very good place for black bear and other animals to live. In addition to providing food, it provided shelter for a lot of wildlife. This is an article from an 1876 newspaper about a chestnut tree that measured 9 feet across. It was cut down and made 700 rails, of course, fence rails. This is what they used chestnut for back then. 230 years old. Now, 230 years old, that's a pretty old tree, but think about 9 feet. I mean, that's still a big tree for 230 years. Some of these chestnut rail fences are still around today. Chestnut is such a rot-resistant wood. This particular fence is on my parents' farm, and it's still standing there, and it still turns cows. Chestnut was used for wooden shingles. Here's a load of wooden shingles here. It split very cleanly. It was easy to split. It was very rot-resistant, easy to work, and highly useful for shingling buildings. Chestnut was used for telephone poles. Wanted to buy 1,000 chestnut poles 40 feet in length. These ads are from 1920. Mr. Bradley wants some chestnut cordwood. I don't know what Mr. Bradley was going to do with cordwood, but there are a lot of things you can do with it. Chestnut is so high in tannic acid that it was used as an important part of the tanning industry for leather working. If you require the services of Jackson and Davis undertakers, they would give you the option of your species for your coffin. They would make them in their own office. I would recommend chestnut. Chestnut was also part of the social scene of the day. 100 years ago, there were no computers, there were no malls. People had to rely on getting outside and amusing themselves and running through the woods. And it sounds maybe kind of primitive, but sounds kind of fun too, doesn't it? Here's the Boucher family. The title of this is Nut Hunting Autumn, and the Bouchers have successfully collected a whole basket full of chestnuts here. And this was the social part of that. The industrial part of this is that huge railroad cars full of chestnuts were shipped off to the Northeast. There were chestnut nut vendors on the streets. If you've been to Europe, you may have seen the same thing, that they cook them right there on the street and they give them to you in a little basket and you eat them, and they're really good, just hot off the grill. That was part of our culture here as well. And so the nuts were shipped off to New York. All the cities had them. All the country people had them. You can make chestnut flour out of them. It's a very nutritious nut. It has really, it's more akin to a grain nutritionally than a nut. It doesn't have so many fats in it. It's more carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates. It's a very healthy kind of nut. All of that began to change when this pathogen entered the United States. This is an American chestnut stem, and you see all these little orange fruiting bodies, as well as a significant discoloration of the stem. This is Cryphonectra parasitica, better known as chestnut blight. It's a fungus that's native to China. It was accidentally introduced into the United States in the late 1800s on nursery chestnut trees that were brought over from Asia, probably Chinese and Japanese trees both. Chestnut was so important to the culture back then, people were always looking for new things to do with chestnut. And so one idea was, let's bring some of these Asian species over. Let's get some of those going. The problem was that they also brought along this fungus. The Chinese and Japanese chestnuts had co-evolved with the fungus, and they have a natural resistance to it. It infects them, but it doesn't generally kill them. American chestnut had never before seen or been exposed to this fungus, so the outcome was very different. Herman Merkel was the forester at the Bronx Zoo, and he's credited with making the first description of chestnut blight. In the summer of 1904, he noticed that the American chestnut trees in the zoo were dying from something, and he didn't know what it was and didn't understand it. And then in June 1905, then it was getting worse. And so he collected some specimens and sent them to the USDA asking for information, what is killing the chestnut trees? Well, the USDA didn't have a clue. Nobody knew about this, even knew about this organism. And so it wasn't initially clear exactly how significant this was going to be, but it didn't take very long for that to become apparent that it was going to be a very devastating event. It was estimated there were 3.5 billion chestnut trees in the eastern United States. And between around 1904 and around 1950, practically all the mature trees practically were dead, and many of the young trees. This is one of the worst ecological disasters in history. This is taking a major anchor species out of the forest with no replacement. You can't take out 25% of the forest and have no impact. The ecological science was relatively primitive back then, and so we really don't even know what we lost. We know we lost a number of moth species, for example, that were wholly dependent on chestnut. No doubt we lost a lot of other things that we don't even know about. If before chestnut blight, it would have made a lot of sense if you were a species of plant or animal or fungus or whatever to anchor yourself to chestnut, because it was such a highly successful tree species that if you were dependent on chestnut, you could always find a chestnut somewhere. If you were a moth and you needed chestnut trees, that's a really good place to be. But those species then didn't have their primary tree to tag onto it after the chestnuts died. Chestnut blight fungus enters the tree through the bark. It invades through the bark and enters the cambium layer, which is the part of the vascular portion of the tree that carries nutrients. And it invades into the cambium, and it basically clogs it up and destroys it. So anything distal, any part of the tree distal to that point is then killed. It's effectively girdled. It's the same thing as taking your axe and chopping all the way around the tree. And it's highly lethal to American chestnut. The younger trees escape a little bit of the infections because they have a smoother bark, and it's a little harder for the blight fungus to lodge on those and stick and then invade. But the mature trees have big corrugations in the bark, and they're a very good target for the Cryphonectra parasitica to hit the tree and enter. So here's progression of disease. Here's a fairly early infection. These are the fruiting bodies here of the blight fungus. You start to see some cracks here in the bark, so it's starting to invade under the bark. And more advanced infection, you're starting to get some cracking there, starting to get some necrosis. There's some discoloration there. This is a larger tree here. Quite a bit of disfigurement going on here. The tree is gradually becoming girdled, and if you look at these trees, you can see them gradually start to yellow and decay away. This is a more advanced infection. There's a whole lot of necrotic tissue here, and this is the same tree, larger view, and you see the tree is turning yellow. And so this whole tree is going to die. There's the blight canker right there. The whole upper part of the tree is going to die. Now, they're good at sprouting, so there are some sprouts there. But the main trunk of the tree is doomed at this point. So blight was discovered in 1904 in New York City. It moved an average of about 50 miles a year and worked its way down the Appalachian chain. No one really at first knew what it was, and then after they figured out what it was, didn't really know what to do about it, but there were heroic efforts to try to do something to save the American chestnut tree. In Pennsylvania, foresters clear-cut whole hillsides, thinking if they could have a vegetation-free barrier, maybe the blight fungus couldn't jump over that. Well, that didn't make any difference at all. It just progressed on through and just crossed over. There were so many chestnut trees that were infected here that there were wind-borne fungal spores was probably one of the main ways that the fungus spread. But it can also be spread by birds and insects and really anything that touches it. Humans either. If you go up and touch one and then you touch another tree, you can spread it. It's very easy to spread. So there was no stopping this thing. Reached Tennessee sometime around 1930. The world record American chestnut tree in 1942 was in the Smoky Mountains. It was 27.5 feet in circumference at chest height with a big flare at the base. I've seen photographs of it. Great, big, beautiful tree. The title of the article in American Forest was Monarch of a Diminishing Kingdom, which is kind of a sad poetic statement about what was happening. And the people, there were a lot of photographs of different people visiting that tree that are available. It was like paying a pilgrimage to something that was on its way out. Tennessee, through the 1930s until about 1940, the trees were dying, and then by 1950, the blight fungus had reached the end of the range down in Mississippi. So, in its wake, it left trees like this. I took this picture about 2 weeks ago. This is a still-standing American chestnut trunk in Great Smoky Mountains National Park. It's the largest standing trunk that I know of. It's 15 and a half feet circumference at chest height with a big flare at the base. And so that puts it roughly 5 feet in diameter at chest height. It's a pretty good sized tree, and it stands about 70 feet tall. It gets a little, deteriorates a little bit more every time I look at it. You see a big chunk of it fell off the top here. But it's still standing, and that's remarkable. That tree's probably been dead for 80 years. And that's a huge bulk of wood that's still standing upright there. If you want to see this, go to Cades Cove. Take the loop, the 11-mile loop around there. And then just past the visitor center, there's a little gravel road that goes straight ahead. The visitor center's right. Take the gravel road straight. And there's a trail that goes to Gregory Ridge. Walk about 15 minutes and look to your left, and you'll see it over there if you look very carefully. It's about 100 yards off the trail. It's worth a trip if you'd like to see old, dead, rotten trees. This is the largest stump that I know of, also in the Smoky Mountains. The first time I saw this stump, it was actually fairly intact, and I could put a tape measure across it, so I happen to know it's 11 and a half feet in diameter. It runs from about here to about here. It's deteriorated some in the past few years. These were sprouts. It was rimmed with sprouts. You can still see several of these, and those were staying at one point. They're starting to fall down now, and so it's looking more and more like just a pile of dirt. But if you know what to look for, and you look for these trunks like this, you can recognize it. That's on the Ramsey Cascades Trail, about a mile and six-tenths in from the trailhead in the Smokies. So that could have been the last slide. If the tree was extinct, then we mourn the loss of the tree. We look at some old, dead, rotten logs, and that's the end of it. But fortunately, that's not the end of the story. This is a living American chestnut tree. This particular one is in the Smokies, but they're found all throughout the native range of the American chestnut, and they're actually quite plentiful. New York State has an estimate that there are 60 million living American chestnut trees in New York State. In Tennessee, there are probably millions of them in Tennessee, too. But they don't get much bigger than this, as a rule. What happens is that the blight fungus is highly lethal to these stems, but it can't penetrate the soil. There are microorganisms in the soil that are also, in turn, lethal to chestnut blight fungus. So it can't kill the root systems, at least not very efficiently. And so these old root systems that were established before the blight wiped out the chestnut trees can still send up these shoots. That's probably an 80-year-old tree. Now, the stem itself may, who knows, maybe 10 or 15 years old, whatever. But the root system is, by definition, 80 years old because there's almost no natural reproduction of chestnut. This has to predate the blight. And we find these all over the place. A good place to go is Savage Falls. If you're familiar with Savage Gulf, take the Savage Falls Day Loop, and you'll find about the hundreds there. You're always within sight of an American chestnut. But they're all like this. Don't be looking up. You'll miss them. You got to look level with your head. They're 2 to 5 feet tall, and they're kind of inconspicuous unless you're looking for them. I've got some leaf samples up here. If you'll take a look at that, and I'll talk a little bit about leaf anatomy as well, but kind of glue that in your mind, and you who have seen chestnuts, you'll know what they look like. But be looking for them, and you'll definitely see them. On my farm, which is in West Williamson County, we found 32 of them. And so they do occur in Williamson County as well. Some of them get fairly large. This one's on Sugarlands Mountain in the Smokies, and it's a good 30 feet tall. I've seen them up to 60 feet tall in the Smokies. This is one of the few places where there's some actual natural reproduction and nut production. And so it's an important place. There's just not enough of it to evolve very efficiently blight resistance. You know, given enough millennia, perhaps it might occur, but it's statistically improbable that it would happen. Most of the trees we see are so small, and chestnut trees are not self-fertile, so they don't reproduce, and so they need some help. And I'll tell you a little bit about that in a minute. This is what's fairly rare, a flowering American chestnut. And this is what we need in order to have reproduction. When we're finding trees out in the woods, we can take cyanwood and graft them, but that's pretty labor-intensive, and it's hard to get a whole orchard full of trees if you're doing that. So we really want to find some that are flowering. So this is one of the most important slides I want to show you tonight. American chestnut has no to minimal resistance to blight. And I used to say no, but it's actually, some trees do have minimal. As you would expect, there are some individuals that are exceptions to the rule. The current Tennessee state champion chestnut tree is in Jackson County. It's 23 inches in diameter. The man who owns the farm has known the tree since the 1940s. It's heavily blighted from bottom to top. It's a really ugly tree. It's not really one you would put up there. It's your poster child of a tree. But it is a surviving American chestnut tree that probably does have some natural resistance. So it's a very important tree for us. American chestnut stump sprouts grow from old root systems that predate blight, and that's again because the blight fungus cannot penetrate the soil. So we still have a lot of genetic diversity among American chestnut. Even though the big trees are gone, there's a lot of diversity out there with all those many thousands to millions of trees that are still living. Oaks are alternate hosts to chestnut blight, and that's a really big deal. When you have a pathogen that causes a pandemic that courses through a population, killing the susceptible individuals, when it reaches the end of the disease process and has killed all the susceptible individuals, then the pathogen generally dies, and then the individual populations can spring back. That won't happen with chestnut blight, though, because the oaks are hosting the chestnut blight, so there's always a reservoir of chestnut blight that can spring back to kill American chestnut. Chestnuts are not self-fertile. So the few trees that happen to get large enough to flower are generally so far apart that they can't pollinate each other. And so, except in rare places like the Smokies or Savage Gulf or someplace like that, there just is not much natural production. Which means American chestnut is at a biological dead end, since it can't reproduce effectively. It's estimated that the tree is far from extinct, and you know, you may hear, you know, people think, well, it's extinct. Well, it's not. It will probably be 500 years to 1,000 years before it becomes extinct, but it is a biological dead end, and that would be the logical eventual outcome if you can't reproduce, that you're eventually going to disappear. But Asian chestnut trees are resistant to blight. They're small orchard type trees. They're not at all a replacement for American chestnut trees. They can't begin to compete for the canopy with oaks and tulip poplars and our other big trees, but they are resistant to blight. And Asian and hybrid American chestnut trees can hybridize, and that's very important. This is my late father in his chestnut orchard, and these are Chinese chestnut trees. They're about 40 years old, make massive amounts of chestnuts, and if you've ever been around chestnut trees in the fall, if you're going down a hill, you gotta be real careful because they'll roll you down the hill. You can almost harvest chestnuts with shovels under these things. They are so productive of nuts. And they're very good trees for that. They're very beautiful trees. But see how they're multi-stem, they're branching, they're kind of wide and all of that. They're not a forest tree at all. This, by the way, is an American chestnut rail fence. My father was passionate about chestnut trees, so he maintained that little fence there. This is a Chinese chestnut tree. It's a healthy tree, produces lots of nuts. It's also got some plaque cankers. See, there's one there, and there's one there, and there. But that's quite different looking than the ones I showed you that were on American chestnut. This tree has laid down some callus. It didn't break through the bark. You don't have that necrotic kind of appearance. And the tree just continues on to grow and make nuts and do the things that trees are supposed to do. So it kind of, it gets infected, but it's not a real big problem for the tree. This is a post oak tree. Post oak and black oak are two of the oaks that are most susceptible to chestnut blight, and it actually can kill them. It usually does it, but it can. This post oak was killed by chestnut blight, and if you look closely, you see these swollen cankers here. It's got a whole bunch of cankers on it. It took a pretty big infection to kill that tree, but eventually it did succumb to chestnut blight. This is a black oak, and if you're familiar with black oak trees out in the woods, they very often have a very big flare at their base. It goes by the unappealing name of butt canker. What that means is that the butt of the tree here gets infected with chestnut blight, and the tree can generally fight that off by laying down callus and kind of expanding and putting down some scar tissue, but it makes it get kind of fat at the base. But when you see that on black oak, it's more than likely a chestnut blight. In the early part of the 20th century, the U.S. Forest Service, USDA, were trying to breed a blight-resistant chestnut tree that would replace the American chestnut tree in the forest. And so they started with Chinese, but they wanted it to look American, so they crossed a Chinese chestnut tree with American chestnut tree. That gave them a tree that had intermediate characteristics, both in growth pattern and blight resistance. So it wasn't as blight resistant as the Chinese. It wasn't as tall as the American. So it really was a very satisfactory input. And so their emphasis was on increasing the blight resistance. So they crossed it back to Chinese. Well, that made it more Chinese looking. It made it more blight resistant. But it didn't really make it more of a tree that would be suitable to put back in the woods. And so they tried this over and over, and it just didn't work. And so by the middle of the century, they had abandoned that program. And so there really wasn't much going on as far as trying to figure out what to do about chestnut blight and replacing the American chestnut. Charles Burnham was a corn geneticist at the University of Minnesota. And after he retired, he was a very intellectual person, and he liked to study about scientific problems and figure things out. And so he was still going to the library every day and reading things, and he was reading about chestnut blight, and he'd been breeding corn forever. Of course, corn's easy. You get at least one generation a year, two or three if you've got a greenhouse. Trees are more complicated, but the principles are very much the same. And he said, you know, the problem is that you don't want to backcross to the tree that you want to eliminate the traits from. You backcross to the tree that for the traits that you want to keep. And so he came up with this breeding program. So the way this works, this is the second most important slide I want to show you tonight. This is a sixth generation flow chart on how to breed a blight-resistant American chestnut tree, and it's based on the work and ideas that Charles Burnham laid out back in the early 1980s. The first cross is Chinese to American, so you get what we call an F1. That tree is intermediate in blight resistance, intermediate in growth. Now, what we want to do is retain the Chinese trait of blight resistance, but that's the only Chinese trait we want. We don't want the bushy orchard-type growth. We want the big upright timber growth. So our next step is to backcross it to American. So we've got 50-50 here in the first generation. We've got 3/4 American in the second generation. Now, at each step along the way here, too, we're also going to select for blight resistance. So we're going to do that scientifically by deliberately inoculating the trees that we're growing here with blight fungus. That will kill the majority of the trees. We'll have somewhere around 10% or less that have sufficient blight resistance to carry to the next generation. But we're selecting the ones that have the blight resistance. We're also concentrating the American traits. The American phenotype, meaning American appearance, is actually very quickly recovered here. These trees, within just a few generations, they start to look very American, really almost indistinguishable from Chinese. So we're down here, we're 3/4 American, 1/4 Chinese. Okay, we're going to do that again. Let's go to 7/8, and again 15/16, and again inoculating with blight fungus all the way. So at this point, we've got a tree that's 15/16 genetically American that has, at this point, a fairly good blight resistance. We've concentrated that over four generations. We've selected for that. So then we're going to intercross that. That is, take two of these BC3s, third generation backcross, cross them, and then cross them again. And then at the end, the sixth generation, then we have a BC3 F3. So it's third generation backcross and then third generation intercross. That tree is 15/16 genetically American. It's highly blight resistant, and it breeds true for blight resistance. And so that's the theory there. And this is where a lot of the work's taking place. This is the American Chestnut Foundation Research Farm, which is in Meadowview, Virginia. It's just over the Tennessee border. This is Mount Rogers, which is the highest point in Virginia. So it's kind of in the shadow of Mount Rogers, if you will. Historically, very good place for chestnuts. And you can see that we're not down the bottom land there where it's too wet. We're up here on the hillside. And each one of these little tubes here is a tree. There are tens of thousands of trees growing up there. There are actually two farms now. A lot of the original work was done here. We branched out. We're doing some work in Tennessee I'll tell you about as well. But this is really This is the exciting place to be, Meadowview, Virginia. This is the Tennessee chapter. Each of the 16 states within the original range of the American Chestnut has formed a state chapter. And the goal of the state chapter system is for each chapter to identify flowering American chestnut trees within their state that can be used to introduce into this breeding program. We want to ensure as much genetic diversity as we can. And so, for example, here in Tennessee, we commonly get 2 weeks in summer where it doesn't rain, it's 100 degrees. In Vermont, they get winters where it's 30 below zero for 2 weeks. And that, those are very different conditions. And so we're going to look for trees that are drought resistant as well as blight resistant. They're looking for cold resistant. So, you know, they're different interests, and it makes sense to diversify this project so that people in their local environments then can find trees that grow there and then introduce them into the program and work on concentrating the blight resistance, et cetera. So we're scouring the state looking for chestnut trees. This is what we call an escape. And there are two trees here. It's a little hard to see. This is American chestnut, and this is a tulip poplar. So they're maybe a little hard to see there in the photograph, but this is the important one right here. It's an escape because it doesn't have any natural blight resistance. It just, by statistics, if you have enough, many thousands or more trees, sooner or later one of them's just going to escape the blight just by chance. And that's what happened with this one. This is a piece of that tree, so you can see it didn't end well for that particular tree. But we did get some scion wood off of that, and so we did some grafts, and so its genes are retained. It's a very nice tree. You know, that's the problem with some of these smaller trees. You don't really know, is this going to be a nice tree? You know, trees are different. If you've planted many trees, some of them grow well and some of them are stunted and all that. When you're dealing with small trees and that's your limit, you don't really know what type of tree you're working on. This one was a very beautiful tree, Edgar Evans State Park. And it was, at the time, it was the second largest known American chestnut tree in Tennessee. So here's a little bit of leaf anatomy. This is pure American chestnut. Biological name for American chestnut is Castanea dentata, dentata referring to dentate or teeth. So if you look along the edge of the leaf here, you see those very sharp teeth. It looks almost like a saw blade. And so that's one thing you look for. See the point of the leaf? It comes to a very sharp point here. If you look at the angle the leaf forms, the base of the leaf forms with its leaf stem, it's an acute angle. It's a very sharp angle there. If you were to turn this leaf over and feel the back of it, or even better, lick it with your tongue, you would detect no leaf hairs. And that's one thing chestnut people do, is they lick leaves. If you ever see chestnut people, don't think it's some kind of mushroom kind of thing going on. It's not that. They're actually looking for leaf hairs, because that's one way you can tell these things apart. New growth on American chestnut often has kind of a reddish tint. And sometimes the stems early in the spring even look kind of reddish. It's a very delicate, I think you'll agree, a very beautiful leaf. I think that's a very appealing, beautiful foliage. This is a trunk from an American chestnut tree. That tree is about 12 years old. It's fairly nondescript. It's fairly smooth here. When these trees get older, they get more corrugations. This is an American chestnut tree that's about 47 inches in diameter. And notice the big kind of coarse-looking bark. That tree grows in West Salem, Wisconsin. And that's outside the natural range of American chestnut, but it's actually where the best example of an American chestnut forest is. About 100 years ago, a farmer migrating there from Pennsylvania or Virginia, I'm not sure, nobody really quite seems to know, but he took along some chestnuts with him. And when he got to where he was going to set up his farm in Wisconsin, he planted these things in a row, and there are about 13 or so of these. Most of them are still living, actually. And over the following 100 years, these chestnut trees spread to about 60 acres. And the original trees were grown in a pasture-type setting, and so they're kind of short and bushy, big trunks, but they don't get so tall. But as the forest filled in, then you start to see the timber growth, and the rest of the trees are really big, tall, beautiful timber trees. It's quite an impressive place to see. It's now infected with chestnut blight. For many years, it escaped that because it was geographically separate from the native range, and so there wasn't such a large population of chestnut blight up there. But via wind or birds or insects or people or whatever, it's become infected, and it's in significant decline now. I've seen it a couple of times, and it changes between times quite negatively. Still very important for research, though, because, again, 60-acre forest. I mean, think about it. The Chestnut's range was 200 million acres 100 years ago, and now the 60-acre forest is the biggest treasure we have. But it is that. It is truly a treasure. This is a Chinese chestnut leaf, very different from the American chestnut leaf. It's a very coarse leaf. It feels almost leathery. And if you look at the base of the leaf here, it forms almost a right angle. With the base of the leaf stem. And the tip of it doesn't have nearly a sharper point. If you were to flip this leaf over, you would actually see the leaf hairs. It looks fuzzy on the bottom. It's even white and very easy to tell. That's a Chinese chestnut. They're very good trees to have. I've got 100 or so of them growing in my orchards, and I like them. They make lots of nuts. They're pretty trees. But they really have no bearing on restoration of the American chestnut. I get calls quite frequently from people saying, I've got a great I've got a great American chestnut in my yard. American chestnut tree in my yard, those two things don't go together. American chestnut trees only grow from the old root systems that were established before blight hit. So they're not going to be anybody's yard unless it's somebody who planted one. So these are all Asian trees. And they're very nice trees, and I'm glad people are proud of them. But they don't really help as far as doing the breeding program. We have specific Chinese trees that we know the traits of that we use for our breeding program. This is another plant you may encounter. This is an Allegheny chincopin. Not chincopin oak. It's an Allegheny chincopin. It's a Native American chestnut species. It's a bushy tree. It gets maybe 6 feet tall. It's a highly desirable plant. It's a beautiful plant. It has leaves, you can see, somewhat reminiscent to American chestnut. They tend to be a little bit fuzzier, and they're much smaller. This is a small plant with smallish leaves. I took this picture about 2 weeks ago, and it's starting to flower. These are the female flowers here. Here's the male flower. And it's going to have little tiny nuts. They're about a quarter of an inch or so in diameter. They're very tasty, but it takes a whole hand. It takes about two dozen of them to make a handful. And so you work all day just to get a taste of them. But they're good for wildlife food. And I know the people here, you're here because you like plants and trees. And so one thing I would suggest to you, if you're looking for great native plants to plant, look at Allegheny chincopin. It's a nice little plant. Chestnuts, if you're thinking about Chinese or American chestnuts in your yard, just remember the burrs. And if you have any questions, walk over there and touch the burrs I've got in that little vase. And just make sure you want one of those in your yard. The Allegheny chincopin, they're more fuzzy than sharp, so it's not so much of an issue. About 10 years ago, Matt Woods was an intern with American Chestnut Foundation, and he spent his summer hiking the Smoky Mountains. And you can see, first of all, he covered a good bit of ground, many hundreds of miles there in the park. These little dots are the flowering American chestnut trees that he found. That's a lot of dots. There are a lot of flowering American chestnut trees in the Smokies. The greatest concentration is right here and right here. I know you all like plants, and so you're going to go out and look at things. If you want to see nice American chestnut trees, Savage Gulf is a good place to go, or Savage Falls Day Loop is a good place. If you want to see some big ones, go up here to the Smokies. The most popular trail in the park is the Laurel Falls Trail. It's paved. It's couple of miles up to a nice waterfall, fairly easy hike. You'll see a few American chestnut trees along the first part of that trail, and that's where everybody stops. They stop at the waterfall, a great place to stop. But keep on going. Shortly after you pass the falls, you enter a magnificent old-growth forest, and you start getting some big chestnut trees. And the farther you go on that trail, the bigger they get. There's some 60-foot-tall American chestnut trees up there. There are lots of 20 and 30-footers, and that's one place you can find some natural nut production. You get up close to the edge of the park where all of these confluent dots are, and chestnut becomes the dominant species. It's really a remarkable place for people who like plants. There aren't many places you can go and see that. Another good place is right across the road from that, the Sugarlands Mountain Trail. You just hike up there, and it ascends fairly steeply for about 15 or 20 minutes, and then it kind of levels out. And then once you get on top, you'll start seeing chestnut trees. They're not quite as big as over here. This is Cove Mountain, so they're not quite as big as on Cove Mountain. But on Sugarland Mountain, you'll see a lot of them. And it's a good place to go as well. And again, a little bit of natural nut production. So we've got lots of trees here. Now, our state chapter is charged with finding 20 flowering American chestnut trees. We could easily find those all in the Smokies, but that's not what we want to do. We want as much diversity as we can. So we'll get, we have a collection permit for the Smokies, so we'll collect some of this, but we're also going to spread out, and we're going to go across the state trying to find other trees that we can breed to. This is an American chestnut flower, and they have just, well, they're still flowering a little bit, but they're just ending the flowering process. I took this picture about a week ago. Chestnut trees have both male and female flowers on the same plant, so you don't have that sexual differentiation that some trees like ginkgos have where there's a male tree or a female tree. They're all both male and female, but they're not self-fertile because the male and female flowers mature at different times. This is the male flower right here, and you see those little dots there. That's the pollen. If you're around chestnuts when they're flowering, it's a very distinctive smell, and people either like it or hate it. There's not really much in between. It's so strong you can smell it driving down the road. And if you know what to look for, you're driving around, you smell it, and then you start looking for the tree. It's a very strong, very overpowering smell. This is the female flower right here, and this is called a bisexual catkin because it has both male components and female components. This is just the male component here. And so what we're doing, when we do our crosses, we want to know what is pollinating that nut. Open pollinated nuts, you don't really know what you're going to get. It might be somebody's Chinese chestnut that pollinates it. It might be some tree that you don't really want the characteristics of. We want to be able to control that. We want to know what crosses we're doing so we can appropriately go down that flow chart. So what we're going to do, if we're going to pollinate these female flowers, we're going to eliminate any very remote possibility that the tree pollinates itself. So we're going to go in there, we're going to clip off all of these male flowers, these male ends of these, and then we're going to put a bag over this female flower. We're going to come back in about a week or so when this female flower is ready to be pollinated, and we're going to take pollen from the cross that we want to make, and we're going to dust that female flower, and then we're going to put the bag back on. Then in the fall, we'll come back and collect those nuts. The purpose of putting the bag, and by bag I mean just a paper bag with a pull tie on it, but putting that on there ensures that no other pollen gets inside there to pollinate that nut. Now the other thing we do, I mentioned cutting the male flowers off. Well, that's the other thing we can do with this particular one. We can take these male flowers, collect them, take them to a female flower somewhere else, and we can bring male flowers from somewhere else and pollinate this female flower. So we can pollinate both ways on these trees. And here's my friend Clint Neal. Clint is one of the people who volunteers to climb up the ladder. So Clint is up there doing the work of snipping off the male flowers and putting the bags over the female flowers. These trees look quite bizarre, as you'd imagine, by the time we get through with them. They've got little white bags all over the place, and it looks like maybe some fraternity prank or something, but it's a very important part of reestablishing the American chestnut. So then we plant them in orchards. This is my own orchard in Williamson County. I'm out on the Highland Rim out in west Williamson County, historically American chestnut habitat. And we plant these trees. I like to direct seed them. You can plant them in pots and transplant them. For me, it works better to direct seed them. And if you direct seed plants, if you just take a nut and stick it in the ground and hope you're going to get a tree, well, you may hope more than you actually get, because seed predators will come out more than likely and dig your nuts up. So you've got to protect them in some way. So we use tree shelters. I've got one of those up here for those of you who may not be familiar with it. That's a Tubex brand. There are lots of different brands. That's the one that I've used for the past 20 years or so. And so what I do is I dig a fist-sized hole in the ground, pack it with wet peat moss, put the nut in. Chestnuts have a round side and a flat side, and I put the flat side down. I don't know if it really matters, but it makes sense to me. The nut falls out of the tree, it rolls till it hits the flat side, so maybe it's kind of natural, I don't know. But I put that down, cover it with about half an inch or no more of peat moss, and then put the Tubex tree shelter over it. And these things are pretty stiff. You can push them down. I push them down as far as I can go with them, which is usually about 3 or 4 inches. You're protecting against seed predators, and just about anything in the world will like to get in there and eat those chestnuts. And that includes groundhogs, voles, squirrels, chipmunks, lots of other things. But the tree shelters actually enable a pretty successful planting. I did a planting this past spring. We got 95% germination rate and no damage at all from any animals. And so it's a good way to overcome those problems. So this is my orchard at about 2 years old. And so you're seeing some trees start to come up out of the tubexes there, some pretty nice looking trees. That's what it looks like at 4 years. Chestnut's a pretty fast growing tree. I've got a cross section of one of the trees up here that we cut out of my orchard this spring. It's laying down a lot of wood. These trees really grow fast. Sometimes I'm asked, how fast does chestnut tree grow? Well, it grows about as fast as corn. It's really a pretty amazing tree. Now you can see a few other features around there. I mentioned voles. I've got some raptor perches here. These are cedar poles with cross pieces. I just went out in the woods and found some dead cedars, cut them down, and bolted some cross pieces to them. They're anywhere from 12 to 24 feet tall. I've got a dozen of those. The problem was the deer were eating my trees, so I put a deer fence around. You see this 8-foot tall deer fence, which kept the deer out. It also kept the coyotes out, so the vole population exploded and the voles started eating my plants. So I saw one problem created another. So I put these raptor perches in there to encourage owls and hawks to spend more time in my orchard. And I want you to think just a minute. We have helicopter patrols over Williamson County all the time. They're looking for people growing illegal agricultural products around the county. Can you imagine what this place looks like? You fly over and you've got a high security fence and a remote hilltop site with a dozen crosses there and lots of little can-looking things. I can't imagine what they think it is. But they haven't firebombed it, so I guess I'm okay in that. So there, we all have favorite trees. This was always my favorite tree. It always seemed to do the best and grow the fastest. That's what it looked like at 4 years. So I'm about 6 feet, a little over 6 feet tall. So it's about 12 feet tall there at 4 years. That's what the tree looks like at 6 years. It's just kind of exploded. It's just a big, beautiful, big, healthy tree. So if you're growing chestnut trees in an orchard and you get trees like that, then what's the next step? The next step is go in there and kill most of them, right? It's a very hard thing to do. One of the people I was talking to said, that must be really hard as a plant breeder. I don't think I could do that, but I guess you get cold and calloused. And the answer is no, it's hard to do, but that's exactly what you've got to do. And this is the poison. This is William White. William, at the time, was the Southern Regional Coordinator for the Southern Appalachian part of the American Chestnut Foundation. So William is holding a culture medium here. This has Cryphonectar parasitica in it, the chestnut blight fungus. We're going to inoculate with two different strains of this. It gives us two different data points. We've got one strain that's moderately virulent, meaning it's moderately damaged in the tree, and then we've got one that's highly lethal, a really nasty version of the blight fungus. And by inoculating with two different blight fungi, or two different strains, then we get a better idea what the tree's going to act like. So William's there with his hand borer. He's drilling a hole into the tree. We're going to do one here, and we're going to do one down there. We're going to put the least virulent fungus on top because some of this could bleed out, and if you put the more virulent one on top, it bleeds into the other one, and then you don't have as good of an experiment. And then we come back in a year and see what happened to it. So here's the less virulent, and this is the more virulent. This is actually the best tree in the orchard here, and so you can see it's not blight-proof. We're only halfway down the flow chart. But it's pretty blight resistant. Here in this lesser one, you see some, it's starting to put some callus down there. It's starting to try to heal that up a little bit. It's struggling a little harder with this more aggressive fungus here. But you don't have that big focus of necrosis like we did on that slide that I showed you earlier. It's trying to wall that off. It's working against it, even though it ultimately may not be successful and may succumb. This is a Chinese chestnut control. Very different pattern. See how thick the callus is around this? It's almost like you cut a limb off and it's just going to grow right back in. So there's the less virulent and there's the more virulent. Now, it did cause a pretty significant infection. We were actually pretty amazed to see what damage that more virulent form did to even a Chinese chestnut. These trees, when I grow them in my orchard, you hardly even notice the blight fungal infection at all, but that really did hit it pretty hard. But it survived and it's actually doing pretty well. This is the other extreme. This is a tree that was killed outright by blight. Both the less virulent and the more virulent forms, they were both lethal infections to this tree. So when we go through and assess, we assess for blight resistance, but also for American phenotype. If a tree looks Chinese, then even if it's blight resistant, we don't want it. That's not what we're looking for. We're looking for trees that look American. And so we're inspecting the leaves there. This is Dr. Hill Craddock. He's a biology professor at UT Chattanooga. He's been called a walking encyclopedia of chestnut information, and that's just about right. He's one of the world's foremost researchers in chestnut science. And so we're looking at these trees to see how American they look. Todd's flyer, if you saw that, it said, come and learn about the state-of-the-art modern techniques being used to restore American chestnut. And I saw that, and it was about the time I was getting my chainsaw out, and I thought, well, that's sometimes the state-of-the-art technique is a sharp chainsaw and a strong back. That's a hard thing to do, to cut down a pretty tree like that. But that's what you got to do. You don't, once you've made the decision and you've got some that are not going to make the grade, you really don't want their pollen floating around your orchard anymore. So you got to go through and cut those things down, as tough as it is. After having babied them for so many years and worked so hard, then you got to go through and kill them. The orchard, we planted this back cross orchard of mine in 2005, and all told, there were around 700 trees that contributed to the experiment. We kept 11 of them. So you can see you kill far more trees than you keep. It's a pretty labor-intensive thing, and it requires lots of trees in order to get the right statistics, because what you're looking for is so rare, you just got to have a lot of bulk in it. This is the same tree. This is what it looked like 2 weeks ago. And this infection is getting a little bit worse, but it's still not an overwhelming infection. This tree may ultimately succumb to chestnut blight, but not for a while. And we have collected pollen off of this tree for 2 years now. And so it's already contributing to the next generation of chestnut trees. And so here's Clint on the ladder again, and he's up there collecting the male pollen. Chestnut trees, they have both male and female flowers on them, but they tend to develop the male flowers earlier than the female flowers. And my trees at this point don't have female flowers on them. At least these back cross trees don't. And so we're limited then to collecting pollen off of these trees to take somewhere else to trees that have the female flowers. We're a low-budget, all-volunteer organization, and so we're very limited by resources. And the limiting factor right now is having enough trees that have female flowers on them to take pollen to. And so that just necessarily slows us down. So there's Clint holding the pollen that he's bagged, and he sent that to several different places. So this pollen is being spread around to do several different crosses. And this fall we'll harvest those nuts, and then next spring then we'll get to establish a new planting. So this is the chart that I showed you earlier. So BC3, this is where my orchard is now. So this is the pollen that we're collecting. And so we have options of going to another BC3. We sometimes do BC4s too, just to add a little more genetic diversity into the picture. But eventually we're going to get down here to these BC3 F3s. Now that I've killed almost 700 trees in my orchard, I cleared out some space. So the next thing to do is to plant some new seeds. So this spring, we established a new planting in my orchard. It happened to be on my birthday. My wife had said, we'll do anything you want to do on your birthday. She said, I'm with you. Just tell me what you want to do. And I said, well, tell you what, how about if we restore the American chestnut tree? And so she was all in. And so my wife and I, we planted 170 chestnut seeds there on my birthday. Got a 95% germination rate, and some of them were already 2 feet tall. We planted the seeds, and they've already grown 2 feet since the end of April. So just say 6 weeks or so. So things are looking up. It's a lot of fun to do that. It's a tough thing killing them, but then when you see this new growth, it's like getting new babies, and it's all going to start again. This is an F3B3. This is a legacy chestnut. Theoretically, this is a highly blight-resistant American-type chestnut tree that will breed true for blight resistance. I say theoretically because it's completed the breeding program, and all the math works for this tree. What we don't know is how will it actually perform in the wild. And so that's something only time will tell. And so there are a number of outplantings, very significant outplantings, on the order of thousands of trees that have been done out in the wild all over the eastern United States to see what happens to them. And we hope that they'll do what we think they're going to do, but we need to prove it. We can't just release the tree to the public and say, here it is, and then find out that actually there was some issue we didn't think about or it didn't perform the way we thought it would. So we have to test these and be sure. And so that slows the time frame down a little bit. Everyone who knows about chestnut is very excited that the tree's coming back. And the next question is, well, when can I get a tree? When can I get some seeds? Well, soon, but not quite yet. They're still in testing. I've got 15 or so trees in my orchard. That's a fairly small planting of those, but I'm looking at them. We'll see how they grow there. Similarly, all over the eastern United States, members of the Chestnut Foundation have planted the seeds, and we're testing them. The more important thing is seeing what these large plantings do in, out in the forest. And so none of us will live to see this forest again, this kind of forest again, but this would be the ultimate goal, is to reestablish the American chestnut tree so that it can again live to be 400 years old and get to be 12 feet in diameter. And so I know you all are people who like to do hands-on stuff, you're tree people, so you know, what can you do? What would you like to do? Well, if you want to see American chestnut trees in the wild, go to Savage Gulf, hike the Savage Falls day loop. Take your swimsuit. There's a great swimming hole at the base of Savage Falls. And just look, you'll see chestnut trees everywhere. For bigger trees, go to the Smokies, go to past Laurel Falls, to Cove Mountain, or Sugarlands Mountain. You'll see some easily 20 or 30 foot trees. If you look carefully, you may see a 60 footer. If you want to treat a plant, you can plant Chinese chestnut trees. Understand that the burrs are an issue if you're putting it in your yard. You can get pure American chestnut trees from the American Chestnut Foundation and elsewhere. And those are good trees to grow. They will live, I've got some I planted in 1996 that are still alive. So they will live for a while. Don't expect them to live to be 100 years old. But planting trees itself, you learn how to plant the chestnut tree, and then you learn what blight does to it, what blight looks like, and you get some nuts off of it. So it's worthwhile doing, even though the lifespan is going to be fairly short. But something else to think about, if you live in town and you just want a little bush to put over somewhere, look at Allegheny chinquapin. That's a very nice native plant to plant. And I think you'd be very happy to have some of those. There are lots of sources for those. Empire Chestnut Company, Greg Miller is the person I use for that. You can find him on the web. But you can also do an internet search for Allegheny chinquapin. As far as further information about the American Chestnut, I've got some brochures up here. Visit the American Chestnut website, American Chestnut Foundation website. You can find a link to the Tennessee chapter website there. We put information about what we're doing. We meet a couple of times a year, and we formal meetings, and then we meet informally to work in orchards and plant trees and do all kinds of things like that. We occasionally do hikes and things like that. So a lot of things you can do. There's really a lot going on with chestnut these days, and it's very exciting for me to be a part of it, and very exciting for me to tell you all about it. And I appreciate your attention. I appreciate everybody being here. I'd be glad to answer any questions that anyone has. Yes, sir.
You said that the male and the female pollen, whatever, the flowers and the pollen, don't mature at the same time.
That's correct.
In the wild, they don't mature at the same time? How do they get together in the wild?
Well, that's a good question. The question was, if the male and female flowers don't mature at the same time, then how do you have any nut production? They don't mature at the same time on the same tree, but there's some variation across the population. So you've got some trees with female flowers that are mature and nearby trees with male flowers that are mature, so the male can pollinate the female there in the wild. The problem is on a single tree, they're going to mature at different times. And it makes a lot of sense for a tree to have that if you're looking at creating the maximum genetic diversity. It doesn't want to pollinate itself. There were so many chestnut trees, there would be no reason for it to have the ability to pollinate itself, because that would be a form of inbreeding. And so that's very likely the way it evolved. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.